And welcome to this jointly sponsored lecture by First Church of Christ Scientist Bel Air and Seventh Church Houston. I'm Jeremy Wilhelm, a Sunday school student at the Bel Air Church. Our speaker tonight will be Julie Ward, who will be presenting her talk, Cherishing Our Children. From her childhood, Julie Ward has always loved to dance. Ballet and jazz soon became her career, and eventually she became a teacher and a choreographer. She still has a special love for dance to this day. Dancing taught her to value discipline, obedience, and persistence, all foundational qualities for the practice of Christian Science. She's used her teaching skills at church as well, where her great love is teaching Sunday school, which she's been doing since she graduated from Sunday school. Her healing practice was born in the late 70s, when her friends and family began asking her to pray for them, for which her lessons of dance were a great preparation. She's now a full-time practitioner and teacher of Christian Science healing and travels from her home in Atlanta, Georgia, where she grew up. Please give a warm Texas welcome for Julia Ward.
Well, that is a warm Texas welcome. Thank you so much. And thank you especially, Jeremy. I was in my 20s. I was sitting at lunch with one of those amazing, radiant women who just glowed with her love of life. She was chattering on about her kids who were backpacking across the U.S. that summer. And she told me about how she prayed for them every day, each day knowing that they were safe in God's presence, and that they would always feel his guidance, his protection, and his love. Now, I was thinking that they were probably about my age, maybe college students. So you can imagine my surprise when she paused and then said, "I don't know why I call them the kids. They're 67 and 69. At that time, I thought it was a wildly funny comment. Weren't they just a little old to still be needing their mama's prayers? But then, I had children of my own. And I began to understand, you never stop praying for them. You never stop wanting all that's good and glorious in their lives. They never stop growing, and neither do you. To me, this is just a hint of what we mean when we talk about God as our Father and our Mother. It's that limitless love that never wears out. It's that absolute benevolence that always cherishes and supports everything that's good and pure and progressive in their lives. This is the love that we all reflect, whether we find ourselves in parental roles or not. So let's take a minute to just think about that kind of love. Now just take a minute to picture a perfect Father. If you were to think of a perfect father, what are some of the qualities of thought that that perfect father would include? You can talk. I'm sorry? Strength. Another one? Guidance. Patience. Discipline. Wisdom, courage, love, consistency. I always think about humor when I think of my dad. Humor. Now, let's turn these things into verbs. If you were to say, a perfect dad laughs, for instance, what else does a perfect dad do? He guides. He forgives. He spends time. That's really good. He protects. He supports. He listens to you. That's great. Anything else? He helps you. Now, flip it around for a minute. and take a moment to think about the perfect mother. What are some of the qualities of thought of that perfect mother? She's nurturing. She's gentle. What else is she? Compassionate. Gentle. Understanding. Joyous. Protective. Providing. Energetic. Amen. Okay, let's do some verbs. A perfect mother inspires. What else does she do? Guides, I think I heard. Loves. Comforts. Encourages. Reassures. Protects. Humbles. Uplifts. When I practice this lecture, I usually practice it with my own mom. And when I ask her this question, she has two answers. A perfect mother cooks and a perfect mother prays. I like both of those, don't you? Sometimes not in that order. You can see, I know, that it's not a matter of father qualities over here and mother qualities over there, is it? And the father, the mother, the teacher, the coach, the grandparent, who is the best, is the one in which those qualities intertwine and they act together as one. Because it's not a matter of gender, is it? It's a matter of oneness. And God is one. One infinite, indivisible expression of perfect, pure good. And that's why in Christian Science we refer to God as both Father and Mother, our Father and Mother. Now, most of you are familiar with the Lord's Prayer. That's the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus said, after this manner, therefore, pray ye. And what was the first line of that prayer? Our Father, which art in heaven. Now, in her book, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, Mary Baker Eddy gives a spiritual interpretation of that prayer. And in that interpretation, she renders the line, Our Father, which art in heaven, as Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. That our is all-inclusive. It has nothing to do with age or gender or geography or theology. It's our Father providing, protecting, supporting us. And it's our Mother nurturing, cherishing, feeding us, teaching us. Our Father, Mother, God, one infinite, indivisible expression of pure good. Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. Everything fits. Everything's in tune. There are no conflicting elements. Now, I want you to pay special attention to that line, Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious, because that's going to be the golden thread that runs through this whole talk. This line came into very sharp focus in my thought back in the early 80s when our newly formed church was having a hard time finding enough people to teach all the classes that we had in our Sunday school and to take care of the little ones in our children's room. Actually, it's a pretty good problem to have, isn't it? So the board of our church made a request of all of the members. This was the request, that we would promise to pray 5 minutes every day for the children of the world. That promise to pray for the children of the world has changed us profoundly. It has brought about so much growth, such a gentling and purifying effect for all of us who made that promise. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that later on. But first, I'm going to tell you about my friend Mary Kay. She was a member of the church, and she took this assignment very seriously. She never missed a day of prayer for the children of the world. So when her husband passed on and her adult children moved out of her home, her prayers led her to open her modest country farmhouse as a haven for children in need. She became a foster mother in her county. And during the time she was a foster mother, over 300 children passed through her home. And most of them attended our Sunday school. She had an old minivan, and she would pull up in front of the church, and that door would pull back, and 6 or 8 or 10 children would come falling out. It was wonderful. Mary Kay told me that during the years that she was a foster mother, she cared for many children who had been neglected or abused. And so her heart welled up with love for them. The first night that they were in her home, she taught them the very first line of a little poem that was written by Mary Baker Eddy as a gift to little children. It goes like this. Father, Mother, God, loving me. The next night, they learned the rest of the poem. Father, Mother, God, loving me. Guard me when I sleep. Guide my little feet up to thee. And after they had learned that poem, she began to teach them the 91st Psalm, which begins, He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You see, she was teaching them about their real home and about their real parentage. Father, Mother, God, loving me. The first child who came into her home was a little toddler named Darren. And during the first year that Darren lived with her, he was healed of a leg deformity. And shortly after that, he was adopted into a stable, happy home. My husband and I had been praying a lot about having children. And it was Darren who inspired us to start thinking about maybe adopting a child. As we prayed about this idea of adoption, these two books were always in our hands, the Bible and this wonderful companion to it, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, written by Mary Baker Eddy. In the Bible, we learned about Moses' adoption by the Pharaoh's daughter. Did you ever think about that as an adoption story? Who would have thought when that little tiny guy was floating in a basket in the reeds by the river's edge, that he would be the one to lead the children of Israel out of bondage in Egypt? And who would have thought that he was the one who was destined to receive the Ten Commandments, 10 commands that would change mankind? But God knew. God knew his specific, holy purpose. And God put him right where he needed to be prepared to fulfill that holy purpose. I thought about little Moses later when I read in Science and Health, Spirit God gathers unformed thoughts into their proper channels and unfolds these thoughts, even as he opens the petals of a holy purpose, in order that the purpose may appear. I knew in my heart that this child that we were cherishing had his own specific, holy purpose, and that God knew that purpose, and that he would unfold the petals in just the right way, at just the right time. You know, every child of God, every single one, has a specific, holy purpose. Each one is special. Each one is unique, each one is needed, and each one is holy. The Bible says, God setteth the solitary in families. If you think about God as infinite principle. It's that perfect intelligence that relates all ideas together harmoniously for their mutual blessing. And we call these groups families. And a family may or may not coincide with the traditional biological sense of family. No one in the history of mankind knew this better than Christ Jesus. One day, when his mother and brothers had come to see him, the disciples went in to tell Jesus that they were there. And Jesus asked a surprising question. He said, "Who is my mother? And who are my brothers?" And then, pointing directly at the disciples, he said, "Behold, my mother and my brothers." And then he indicated that his mother and brothers and sisters were they who do the will of God. Now, you might be sitting there right now thinking, "I'm not so sure why I'm listening to this talk. I don't have any children. Or maybe all my children have long ago grown up and left and they don't need my help." Think about what Jesus said. Who are your children? Who are your brothers and sisters? You might be a parent or a brother or a sister to a child that you've never even met yet. And why is that? Because you do the will of God. You love. The Bible is filled with examples of parents who prayed for their children. Think about Hannah, the Shunammite woman, Sarah and Abraham. These weren't helicopter parents. They weren't hovering over their children's every move. They had decided to put God first in their own lives. And then, inevitably, they trusted their children to God, to our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. Did you ever think what it would be like to be Mary and Joseph? They must have had such a sacred sense of what it meant to be entrusted with this very special child. What can we learn from Mary and Joseph about the purest sense of parenthood? Well, first, they had to let go of the traditional sense of even what it meant to be a parent. They had to be humble and obedient. They had to listen to angels and obey, even when the angels' messages didn't make a whole lot of sense to the traditional material mode of thinking. When Mary was told by an angel that she would be the mother of Jesus, she very naturally said, "How shall these things be, seeing that I know not a man?" The angel's answer speaks to the heart of every parent. The angel said, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee." The Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth and love, comes upon us. We realize that the child is God's creation and not our own. And then we trust God to uphold and support and protect his own creation. We acknowledge God as the one only creator. And then you and I become grateful witnesses to that creation with all its beauty and light and joy. Our hearts well up, as Mary's did when she said, "Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." Can you see the complete surrender of human pride and human opinion in that answer? There's another thing I love about Mary and Joseph. They didn't just wish their boy would be more like the other kids, did they? They must have glimpsed his unique spiritual role. And so they selflessly provided an atmosphere where that special spiritual identity could flourish and be protected. I imagine that Mary and Joseph were very ready to learn from their child. Are we willing to learn from ours? Well, my husband and I have learned so much from our children. And by the way, we did adopt them both from Korea. And after we adopted Jamie and Katie from Korea, another couple in our church adopted two little girls from Korea. And then another couple adopted a boy and a girl from India. And then another couple adopted a little girl from Russia. And after that, another couple moved to the church who had three little girls from Russia. We like to think that we've been literally obedient to that biblical command, bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. But you know, this daily prayer for the children of the world has done so much more than just bring these wonderful children into our lives and into our church. It has changed us. It has caused us to cherish and support the childlike qualities of thought wherever we see them. Qualities like spontaneity, receptivity, meekness, honesty, purity. And a wonderful thing happens. The more you cherish those qualities of thought in every child that you see, even on the news, the more you begin to feel those qualities blossom in your own thinking. They have no expiration date. Mary Baker Eddy, who was the author of Science and Health and the founder of the Christian Science Church, had a deep, abiding love for children, and she healed many children. My favorite of those healings took place on July 4th, 1897. On that day, Mrs. Eddy had invited a large number of her students and church members to come to her home in Concord, New Hampshire. And among those present was a young mother who had a little boy and a little girl, aged 7 and 9. Now, the little girl had developed a large boil right on the top of her head. It was very painful. She was so uncomfortable, she couldn't even wear the little straw hat that they had bought for the occasion. But they decided they would go ahead out to this wonderful gathering, and they did. Mrs. Eddy said a few words to the people who were there, and then she stood in the porte cochere of her home, and a sort of a informal receiving line started, and people passed through just saying hello. But when the little boy and the little girl got up to Mrs. Eddy, they just stopped, and they stood there beaming up at her, and she was beaming back at them, and this moment of perfect love. And then she just blew a little kiss to each one of them, and they passed on through the line. I want to read to you what the mother of those two children wrote about her experience at that moment. She says, "I wish I could make the world know what I saw when Mrs. Eddy looked at those children. It was a revelation to me. I saw for the first time the real mother love, and I knew that I did not have it. As I turned in the procession and walked toward the line of trees in the front of the yard, there was a bird sitting on a limb of a tree, and I saw the same love poured out on that bird that I had seen flow from Mrs. Eddy to my children. I looked down at the grass and the flowers, and there was the same love resting on them. It is difficult for me to put into words what I saw. That love was everywhere, like the light. But it was divine, not mere human affection. I looked at the people milling around on the lawn, and I saw it poured out on them. I thought of the various discords in this field, and I saw for the first time the absolute unreality of everything but this infinite love. It was not only everywhere present, like the light, but it was an intelligent presence that spoke to me and I found myself weeping as I walked back and forth under the tree, saying out loud, "Why did I never know you before? Why have I not known you always?" On the carriage ride back to the hotel, the mother said that she saw that same consciousness and love everywhere. And when they got back to the hotel, there was no boil on her little girl's head. I think about that healing often. And I ask myself, what did Mary Baker Eddy see when she looked into the face of that little girl? And what did Mrs. Eddy discern in the thought of the mother? And how was it changed? And most important, could you and I see that same intelligent presence of love everywhere? And how would that change us as parents and teachers, as advocates for children all over the world? Well, through these years of praying for my own children and praying for the children of the world, I've come through to a few just basic guidelines, just some basic rules that have helped me be more disciplined in my prayer. And I'd like to, in the next part, just walk you through some of those guidelines with a little example of each one. Now, we've actually already talked about the first guideline. Recognize one infinite Father, Mother, God. You remember, our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. Now, the more you and I feel that sweet fathering, mothering love, protecting and guiding and nurturing us, the more we will feel that same impartial love just embracing all of God's children everywhere. Nobody's left out. No one is fragile or vulnerable. Each one is eternally related to God, and so each one is complete. That takes us to guideline number two. The second guideline is this: honor their completeness. Refuse to think of them in terms of lack. So easy to fall into thinking of our little folks as works in progress, establishing their relationship with God as they work their way down a timeline. But actually, they are eternally related to their Father, Mother, God. And because they're always related to their Father, Mother, God, they are eternally complete. When we were in the process of adopting our son, our first child, we went through a waiting period while all of his paperwork went through immigration and naturalization services. It took about 90 days. It seemed like about 90 years to me. During that time, we only had one piece of paper with a brief history and two little photographs of him. When we received those two little photographs, I can't even tell you. We were just overwhelmed with love for him. We've been loving him for months before. We've been cherishing every quality of God that we knew he included. But now he had a name and a face, and our prayers for him became so much deeper and more consistent. There were two things that really helped us to pray better in science and health. One thing comes from the glossary of science and health. It's such a wonderful thing that science and health has glossary where you can find spiritual definitions of scriptural terms. And we use the definition of children. And it starts like this: the spiritual thoughts and representatives of life, truth, and love. Isn't that a wonderful way to think about children? And later in that same definition, there was one phrase that really caught my attention. It said, not an embryo, but in maturity. Isn't that an amazing concept? Not in embryo, but in maturity. So when I looked at those little pictures, as I did 100 times a day, I saw this little guy sitting up in his high chair, but I saw that he included all the might and intelligence and love of God in all of its completeness. And there was another thing that helped us. On page 475 of Science and Health, there's a question. What is man? Well, each day, my husband and I took that question and we put our baby's name in it. What is Jamie? And we would put his name in each part of the answer. This is my favorite part of the answer. He is the compound idea of God, including all right ideas. Isn't that amazing? The compound idea of God, including all right ideas. Think of that. That's true for you and me too, isn't it? Each one of us includes every right idea. Now, we don't have to have somebody to plug us into our divine source and find those ideas for us. They're always available. They're always ours. And we saw that. When Jamie arrived, he had such a sense of maturity and wisdom and completeness. It just never ceased to surprise us and delight us. But you know, sometimes we forget. And we begin to think that good is out there somewhere. That it's out there in people and things and circumstances. And if we start to think that, then as a parent we think, I have to go out there and get these things and bring them to my child. That's how I thought when Jamie was ready for preschool. At that time, we were living in a second-story condominium in a building where there were no other children actually in the whole neighborhood, and we didn't have a yard, so if you wanted to go out and play, you kind of had to play in the parking lot. We'd been trying to adopt a second child, but everywhere we turned, we hit roadblocks. We'd found a great preschool for him, but we couldn't begin to afford it. So I was feeling like a complete failure as a parent. Until one day, when I was praying about this, and as I prayed, an inspiration from God came to me so clearly that I felt as if God was shouting at me. And this is what I heard. Don't you dare. So I said, don't you dare what? And just as clearly, very forcefully, I heard, don't you dare think of this child in terms of lack. At that moment, I realized that unwittingly, I had been breaking one of the Ten Commandments. I had been bearing false witness against my neighbor because I was thinking of Jamie as a little empty vessel that I had to fill. Immediately, I went back to the prayer that we had prayed before we met him. I knew that he was the compound idea of God, including all right ideas. So, he included the right idea of home, of friends, of school, of family. So, instead of feeling sorry for him, I began to be grateful for all the good that I knew he already included. And guess what? The walls began to tumble down. First, we were able to pay for his preschool in a way that we would never have guessed. It was like manna falling from heaven. After that, two little girls moved into our building. Then the weather started to get warm, and we realized that although we didn't have a yard, we had quite a luxurious swimming pool area that nobody used during the day except us. So almost every day, we had little friends over to come and swim with us, or if it was too cool to swim, big wheels on the tennis court did very well. But best of all of the obstructions to our second adoption just dissolved. And in a matter of months, his little sister was in our home. Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious, was called calling our family together in just the right way at just the right time. Once again, I went back to that wonderful line that I had prayed with before we met Jamie. Spirit God gathers unformed thoughts into their proper channels and unfolds these thoughts, even as he opens the petals of a holy purpose, in order that the purpose may appear. And that is happening right now for you and for your family. Spirit is opening the petals. Spirit is calling you together to bless and support one another. Christ Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." Isn't that a wonderful thing for us to acknowledge? When we are gathered together with the Christ in our midst, in the name, in the nature of Christ, the Christ remains in our midst. And it purifies us and heals us and it uplifts us. It's a very good thing to acknowledge that Christ is always in the midst of your family. It's especially helpful when you go through rocky times. And sometimes we do have rocky times. We have times that call on us for a greater expression of patience and humility and unselfishness. So I want to tell you about one of those rocky times in our family as our next point. Here's the next guideline. Don't fight human will with more human will. It was our daughter Katie who taught us about this one. When Katie was a baby, she was such a beautiful little baby that I couldn't go to the grocery store, the shopping mall, or the park without people coming up and just oohing and aahing over her. They all wanted to touch her and talk to her. And almost without fail, these sweet, sweet conversations with these people who loved our baby would end like this. "You have a beautiful little China doll." And I would say, "Yes, thank you." And then I would think, but underneath she's Rambo. She was a darling little girl, and she was so sweet and dear and happy as long as she got everything she wanted. But if not, she could make my life pretty miserable. Now, I did not want to spend my life butting heads with my daughter. So I decided I needed to pray about this. And I needed to pray not to change Katie, but to change Julie, to become a better parent. There's a poem written by Mary Baker Eddy called "Feed My Sheep." And that poem begins with the word, "Shepherd, show me how to go o'er the hillside steep." And I would sort of paraphrase that line, "Shepherd, show me how to be a better parent. Even if it is a tough, steep climb, I want to go up higher. I want to see my children from the place that you see my children. I want to know them as spiritual ideas." The shepherd did show me how to go and how to grow when Katie was ready for preschool. At that time, her outfit of choice was a pair of little black Lycra bike pants. You know those that come right above the knee? She wore black bike pants and a t-shirt every day of her life. Her little closet had lots of cute outfits. There were those nice little smock dresses. I was so excited about the smock dresses and the little patent leather shoes. But Katie would have nothing to do with it. She wore those black bike pants to birthday parties, to play dates, to school, to Sunday school. Once at a wedding, we ended up going to the wedding with black bike pants under our dress. For her fourth birthday, we gave one of those little girl tea parties. We thought we'd get her to dress up. All her little friends came in little dresses and hats and gloves. Guess what Katie wore? Black bike pants and pearls. An alarming thought began to sort of whisper in my ear, and it went something like this. If it's like this at 4, what's it going to be like at 14? So I began to pray more deeply, to see her only as God saw her. And I began to ask our Father, Mother God, what do you know about this little girl? And one day as I asked that question, the answer came to me so simply, but it answered it for me. This is what I heard. She was not born of the will of the flesh, so she is not programmed to act out the will of the flesh. She was born of God. I began to understand that she was not a little human mind walking down a timeline, building her sense of identity by rebelling against her parents. Her identity was intact, and her identity was wholly spiritual. So the next time we stood in the closet having our usual debate, I didn't argue. I prayed. As I stood there, silently declaring, she is not a willful little mortal. She is not a willful little mortal. Our shepherd spoke to me. This is what I heard. And you are not a willful big mortal. I was completely humbled. At that moment, the next verse of that poem, Feed My Sheep, came flashing into my thought. And that verse begins, thou wilt bind the stubborn will. And I saw it in a flash. You don't bind stubborn will with more stubborn will. That thou in that sentence refers to the shepherd. It's the shepherd who binds the stubborn will. And how does the shepherd bind stubborn will? With steadfast love. So did Katie stop wearing black pike pants at that moment? No. But she did start to be open to other options. And as for me, I began to see the practicality of those bike pants for a little budding gymnast who actually spent more time upside down than right side up. Eventually, she grew out of those bike pants. Thank you, Lord. And she developed the most amazing sense of style. Today, she's the one who gives me the fashion tips. The shepherd is still guiding us both. Remember, don't try to bind stubborn will with more stubborn will. Yield to the divine will. Because as we yield to the divine will, that will includes only progress and joy and fulfillment for every child of God. Now, earlier we talked a little bit about Mary and Joseph as role models for parenting, and we were saying that they didn't have to micromanage Jesus' life. They knew that God was his father and mother, and that he was being gently guided and absolute in his safety and his wholeness. I so imagine that they learned from him day by day. And I want to use that as our next guideline. Be willing to learn from children. They have so much to teach us. If we'll just step away from that teacher role and be willing to be taught. I remember when Jamie was about 8 years old, he taught me how to take my prayer up higher. We had been having dinner with some friends, and Jamie was seated across the table from me. And I looked across, and I saw he was kind of pale and listless, and he wasn't eating. And this was a guy who pretty much ate everything that didn't eat him first. So I was a little bit concerned, and a little bit, he said, Mom, could I just go in the other room and lie down on the floor? And I thought, that's really not like him. So I followed him into the living room, and I put my arms around him. And when I did, I realized he had a high fever, and he was having chills. So we thought it was time to go home. We said our goodnight to our host and hostess, wrapped him up, and headed for home. And we were praying and singing hymns all the way. Now, I want to say here that we had every expectation that Jamie would be quickly healed, because ever since we had had the children, we had turned first to God at every time there was a problem. And when we had turned with all our heart to God, we'd always seen quick, decisive results. So we were very expectant of a healing. We got home, got him into bed, and I sat by his bed and talked to him a little bit about God. In his Sunday school class, they had been learning about finding the spiritual counterfact of any discordant situation. Now, by this I mean that they could take anything that the five material senses were reporting and flip it around so that they could see what God was knowing and seeing. So I said to Jamie, what is it that is knocking on your door here? What is it that we need to see through? And he said, oh, Mom, I'm so hot, and then I'm so cold. So I asked him, can you tell me the spiritual counterfact of that? I have to admit, I was sort of a jump ahead of him. As soon as he said that, I started thinking three bears. Not too hot, not too cold, just right. But Jamie was so far above me. He was quiet for a minute. And then he said to me really thoughtfully, I'm not in matter to be hot or cold. It took my breath away. He had gone right to the heart of it. And the truth that was revealed to him was so pure that I knew he was free. I knew he would be healed. So I said, okay, you just pray with that. I'm going to go into my room and I'm going to pray with that too. I went into my bedroom and sat on the bed for 15 or 20 minutes, knowing that he was not in matter to be hot or cold, to be old or young, to be sick or well. And when I really had a conviction about that, I went back into his room, and he was as cool as a cucumber, sleeping soundly. I checked on him several times through the night, but he was always fast asleep. And the next morning, he popped out of bed, went to church, got in trouble with his little buddies the way he always did. There was not one trace of the illness. He didn't need me to be the medium or the interpreter to connect him to God. God spoke to him directly in exactly the terms that he could understand and utilize. I always think, when I think of this healing, about a wonderful simple sentence in Science and Health that to me sums up the whole thing. It says, the intercommunication is always from God to his idea man. Not from God to big man down to little man, but straight and pure. From God to his idea man. That takes us to the next one. Next guideline is take them off the timeline. Refuse to see states and stages. Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus was so aware of his eternal relationship with his Father, Mother, God, that he was not held in the bonds of time. We cannot imagine a toddler Jesus throwing a tantrum. And we can't imagine a teenage Jesus being all sullen and rebellious. At 12, he was in the temple. He was reasoning with the priest and the rabbis. I can't imagine they had to talk down to him. Mary Baker Eddy said, man in science is neither young nor old. He has neither birth nor death. Now, if we have neither birth nor death, how could we have states and stages in between birth and death? But what do we have instead? We have wholeness, completeness, and immortality. How often do we think of our children in those terms? And how often do we think of ourselves in those terms? I told you about that clear voice that I heard, that clear inspiration when Jamie was ready for preschool, when I heard God shouting at me, "Don't you dare think of that child in terms of lack." Well, I thought at that time that it was so life-changing that I could never forget it. But I have to tell you, I forgot it. When do you think I forgot? When he was in high school. At that time, our family had moved from our home in Atlanta, Georgia, up to the Boston area. And it was a tough move for all of us. But it was particularly tough for Jamie. At that time, I thought I saw all kinds of lack in that boy. Lack of respect, lack of discipline, lack of friends, lack of respect and love for his parents, most of all. He'd always been such a good boy, and he'd been such a good student, and now it was like he was doing everything he could to fail. He was in a high school that put a huge amount of pressure on the students to go graduate and go to a four-year college. So even as a freshman, there was just this constant talk about how this was going to affect your college admissions. I remember when he was toward the end of 10th grade going to a meeting. It was in a room maybe half the size of this room, and the whole room was covered with posters of colleges and universities in the Boston area. And each poster listed the requirements for admission to that university. Things like SAT scores, grade point averages, essays, extracurricular activities, references from teachers. I looked around that room desperately trying to find one poster that would make me feel better. I was overwhelmed. Within a couple of weeks, I had a call from his Spanish teacher. He'd barely been passing Spanish, but it looked like he was going to get through. But the Spanish teacher said that on the day of the final exam, Jamie had marched to the front of the room and very dramatically ripped his exam into little shreds, thrown away the exam, and marched out. She was going to have to fail him. I cannot even tell you how I felt that night. I was so full of fear and anger and frustration. I couldn't get my thought under control. So I decided I needed to call a Christian Science practitioner. Now, in case you don't know, a Christian Science practitioner is someone who gives his or her full time to prayer in Christian Science. And the wonderful thing about a practitioner is that anyone of any denomination can call on a Christian Science practitioner, and they'll be so happy pray with you and help you find a spiritual solution to any problem that you might be facing. So I called my friend the practitioner, and I poured out my tale of woe. And she paused for a minute, and then she said, "Julie, do you know what's wrong with you?" Then she said, "You see this boy walking down a timeline, and you think it goes something like this. If he does well in high school, he'll get into a good college. And if he does well in college, he'll get into a good graduate school, and then he'll get a good job, and out here somewhere there's a home and a family. But you think that if he messes up at any point on that timeline, he'll forfeit his right to the rest." Well, that's exactly what I thought. But then she said to me so vehemently, "Take him off the timeline." She said, "He already includes his education. He already includes his career. He already includes his family. Now." I saw exactly what she was getting at. There were no contingencies in God's plan for this child. There were no detours, and there were no failures. He could not sabotage his own precious spiritual identity, because he couldn't undo what God had already done. So I started to worry about him less and pray for him more. And a very interesting thing happened. His grades didn't improve. He did fail Spanish. But he got into a wonderful university. We still can't figure out how that happened. Only God could have done it. But he got into this wonderful university and he had a wonderful experience there. God was opening the petals. God was preparing him to fulfill his own unique spiritual purpose. You know, God does that for every one of his dear children. No one is left out. No one can miss an opportunity for good because they are eternally related to God and God is infinite good. That takes me to the last point. The last guideline is this. Fear not. They can't get outside of God. In this age of helicopter parents, we sometimes equate love for our children with fear for our children. And to be honest, sometimes that feels pretty justified. Because the world seems like a much more dangerous place now than it did when we were growing up. So we have a choice to make. Are we going to spend our time fending off one error and then another and then another and then another? Or are we going to lift up the omnipotent power of good? When our children were babies, I always left their room at night with one sentence from Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures. It was this: God is everywhere, and nothing apart from him is present or has power. That's so important, I want to say it again. God is everywhere, and nothing apart from him is present or has power. I should tell you, I continued doing that until they went off to college, and had they let me, I would have texted that every night. I felt that whatever they had to meet in life, that sentence would cover it. They couldn't get outside of God. They couldn't run away from God, and they couldn't be taken away from God. Wherever they went, infinite love would already be there. And there's no other power but love. Nothing can oppose infinite love. And you know what? There are no danger zones in the presence of infinite love. We learned this when Jamie was deployed to Afghanistan during his military service. Sometimes I would just be overwhelmed with fear for him. Sometimes I'd wake up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat. And sometimes I'd be driving along and I'd have to park the car and cry for a little while. But before he left, we'd made a promise to one another. His dad suggested this, that whenever any one of us was afraid, we would meet in the 91st Psalm. Now, by this I mean that we would turn to the promises of God's protection that are throughout the 91st Psalm, and we would actively claim them, not just for our child, but for all of God's children. So we turned to that psalm many times, and we looked it up in the Bible in different translations. There was one that meant a lot to me. It was in the contemporary paraphrase of the Bible called The Message by Eugene Peterson. I just want to read you verses 3-5 because these were the ones that I just love. He rescues you from hidden traps, heals you from deadly hazards. His huge outstretched arm protects you. Under them you're perfectly safe. His arms fend off all harm. Fear nothing. Not wild wolves in the night, nor flying arrows in the day, not disease that prowls through the darkness, nor disaster that erupts at high noon. Fear nothing. Their Father, Mother, God, all harmonious, the God who loves to love them, is already with them, guiding them, supporting them, protecting them. They are always safe in love's everlasting arms. I want to share with you a poem that has meant so much to me as I've prayed for children. I hope you'll love it as I do. This one was originally published in the Christian Science Journal, and it's by a woman named Holly Suey. And the name of the poem is Only a Lamb. In a dream that seemed so real, I heard my child calling to me to save him. Frantic, and with all my strength, I rushed to the scene, finding him already beyond my reach. My heart cried out to my God and his. It was then I woke to hear Christ speak. God, love, is like a shepherd who carries his lambs in his arms all the day long and all the night long, who never puts one down and never lets one down. My dear lamb, God said to me, I have never asked you to be the shepherd. Both lambs were saved. We have never been asked to be the shepherd. We are asked to be God's tender, obedient lambs. Lambs who trust their shepherd completely and follow their shepherd consistently. Can we do that? Yes, we can. So let's take a little quick trip back through those guidelines so that you can take them home with you and use them in your prayer for the children of the world. Think about it. 5 minutes a day. Think what we can do, just those of us in this room, if we pray for these children 5 minutes every day. So you remember, the big headline for the talk is that line from Science and Health with the Key to the Scriptures. Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. That's so important, I want us to say it together, shall we? Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious. From that, you get the first guideline. Recognize one infinite Father, Mother, God. After that, the next guideline is honor their completeness. Refuse to think of them in terms of lack. Honoring their completeness, we won't see them as these little minds that we're trying to make in our own image. And then we'll be obedient to the next guideline. Don't fight stubborn will with more stubborn will. Remember those little black bike pants. And honoring their completeness will make us willing to learn from our children. Just as I learned from Jamie that night, he told me he wasn't in matter to be hot or cold. And then as we're willing to learn from our children, inevitably, we will take them off the timeline. We'll refuse to see states and stages because we know they are eternally related to their Father, Mother, God, and they live in the eternal now. And when we know that, we can't be afraid for them. Fear not. They can't get outside of God. They will never miss any opportunity for good. Wherever they go, God is there. And wherever you go, God is there. Remember, we have not been asked to be the shepherd. We are God's tender, precious obedient lambs. So let the shepherd feed you and guide you and protect you and support you. Then both lambs are saved. Thank you so much.